meeting and praise God. Praise the Lord.
Brother Eli, would you collect some of his squad from place? Well, good morning, and what a beautiful day it is to be in the house of the Lord.
Praise God.
Sun is shining, it's starting to get a little bit warmer outside. We've been talking about personal evangelism. Do you have my little verse for last time? I was just curious. I can wing it if I have to. But we've been talking about personal evangelism. And when we look at personal evangelism, whose responsibility is it to go out and win the lost? It is ours. It is every Christian who's ever lived. What did Jesus say in John 16, 15? Go ye into John. Let's try Mark 16, 15. That says something different. Mark 16, 15 states, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. God also told us something important in Psalm chapter 2 and verse 8. If someone would please read Psalm 2, 8. Ask of me, and I will give you the heathen for your inheritance. When we look in the book of Proverbs, it tells us, he that winneth souls is wise. As we look at the Word of God, we see the heartbeat of God. And God did not send his only Son to come to the earth just to give us gifts, but the main reason he came was to seek and save that which is lost. And when he's gone away, now we are his hands extended. Several weeks ago, we talked about several different methods to evangelism. Is everyone's method when it comes to evangelism going to be exactly the same? Probably not. Because we're all different. We're all comfortable with different things, different types, different approaches. It will have the same message, the gospel message, but it will have different approaches. Like I said, it's important for us now, before we go and seek the lost, that not only do we pray, we talk about the importance of praying and fasting. We talk about it over and over and over again. And not pushing it under anything or minimizing it, but we need to come up with a game plan. You know, what is going to be our approach? Brother Eli, if I come knocking on your door for any reason, I'm going to have a reason to knock on your door. I'm not going to knock on it for no reason. But I'm going to have something in mind, what I'm going to say, what I'm going to ask you, have an idea maybe where the conversation is going to go, and maybe how I'm going to leave you. When we go knocking on doors and inviting people to church, we can't just approach them and look all dumbfounded. There's a reason we're there. What is our reason? What is our goal? What do we want to leave them with? How do we want to conclude it? What is our determination of? What do we seek and hope to gain from it? What do we want them to do as a result? What are we hoping? Where are we planning on going? Having a game plan. Maybe have a game plan on how you want to. What's the first thing you want to say when they open that door? What's the first thing you're going to say when you sit down and talk to them? Have something in mind. When a preacher gets behind the pulpit, for the most part, if God's been working on him, he might have something that he plans on opening with. Typically, I know for me as a preacher, it's not always the same, but Brother Eli, I like to start out with my title, my main verse, and then I want to go to prayer. Before I get up there, I know that's what I want to open up with. Does it always work that way? No, sometimes God changes it. But I still have a game plan on how when I go up there. If God changes it, maybe there's no title. I still have a game plan on what's going to happen when I get behind the pulpit. Where do I want to start? And we need to do the same when it comes to personal evangelism. The Jehovah's Witnesses, when they come to your door, do they have a game plan? Do they have something in mind? Absolutely. They have their little rundown. And what happens if you get them off their spiel? Well, they get confused because they don't know where to go from there. But they have a game plan. If we are going to go door to door, we need to have a game plan. And that's what we've been working on. How to lead people to Christ. Having a game plan. Where do we want to go? What do we want to say? And we got a little bit more organized when we began talking about the Romans Road. Which, of course, with the Romans Road, we've seen that bleed over into Nate Crump's method. You know, there are some things that cross over. Different methods, but some of the same stuff's there. God's message is going to stay the same. Jesus Christ died for your sins, rose again. Do you want to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? But when we look at all these methods, they all begin with showing one important thing. And Ray Comfort talked about it over and over and over again. We are not to give them a gospel message that makes their life, quote unquote, better. We need to show them that they're lost. Because if they are going to accept Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, first they have to see that they're lost. And he talked about Romans 3:23. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Romans 6:23. For the wages of sin is death. You know, we need to show them that they're lost. We saw that with Nate Crump's method as well. And of course, hopefully, I gave you a quick outline of them in your notes. You have a whole different appendix with the Romans Road. Show them what they're lost. Show them what they have to do. Then you have a follow-up. But when we come, if somebody is willing to accept Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, do we stop there? Do we say, great, you accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you're good to go? No. It's like everything else in life. You have to guide them along the way, help them along the way. You need to be a role model, you need to mentor them. We need to show them how to dig deeper in Christ. Because it's not just enough to have our sins forgiven, but God's given us so much more that, to be honest, even us as Christians, we don't even utilize. There is so much to God. So we need to help them along the way. We need to get them started off. So we're going to get them established in Bible reading. Get them something to read. Maybe we need to get them a Bible in their hand. What else might we do to help them along the way?
Invite them to church.
One of the first things we should do is invite them to church. You know, it's one thing, it's great that you accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. Now you need to find yourself a good church to go to. Why don't you come to the same church I go to? They are great people. I'll get you in touch with the pastor, get you his phone number, you can talk to him, and join us this Sunday. And is inviting them to church one time enough? No, because if you talk to them on Monday, there's a whole week that goes through the way. For me as a minister, one thing I like to do as soon as I'm done preaching is I like to give my all. I don't want somebody else to do it. I want to do it. I don't want to end the service there unless the Holy Ghost is already moved. Because the altar call is where people make things real. Where God is dealing with them, they're making commitments. One time is not enough when it comes to inviting them to church. If, say it's a Monday or a Wednesday, there's several days in between. I may call you back up on Saturday and just reconfirm and read. If you need a ride to church, we'll give you a ride to church. So just give them a call, get their phone number, and give them a call on Saturday or go back and knock on their door again. Hey, church is tomorrow. Just want to make sure that you're still coming. You know, just a quick follow-up. You want to get a Bible into their hands. Maybe we want to start them on a devotional. Whether it be Come Away My Beloved, Oswald Chambers, Streams in a Desert. There are a lot of different devotionals out there, but we need to get them grounded in the Word of God. If they're going to make an impact in their own lives, if they're going to allow God to make an impact in their life, they need to get grounded in the things of God. We see what happens in the book of Romans with the carnal man and the spiritual man. Even if they are sincere, that war between the flesh and the spirit are constantly at war still. So they need to feed their spirit. They need to get grounded in the things of God. They need to know what they believe and why they believe it. Because if they don't, guess what's going to happen? If they give their heart to Christ when you go knocking on their door at 8 o'clock Monday morning, guess what might happen at 9 o'clock Monday morning? And here comes the Jehovah's Witnesses. Oh, you're a Christian, that's great. But now we have two different conflicting doctrines. One's not even the gospel of Jesus Christ, but they're open, so they're willing to accept anything. So we need to get them established in the Word of God, that they know, get a chance to know the Bible for themselves. Because the other thing, too, is probably a lot of us in here have been going to Sunday school from way on little on up. Which means every time we've gone to Sunday school, every time we've gone to church, you know, I was raised in Christian school, it was drilled into me. The Bible was drilled into me. I knew the basic Bible stories. Samson and Delilah, Adam and Eve, Jonah and the whale. But if they've never been into church before, they don't know any of this. When I was in college, I was sitting in a history class, and they had a cartoon, political cartoon up, and it was Samson and Delilah. You know how many people in my classroom knew who Samson and Delilah were? Very, very, very few. They weren't around it. So we're dealing with people who may not have ever gone to church. So we need to get them grounded in the Word of God. We need to get them solidified in it, that they get a knowledge for themselves. Get a Bible in their hands so they can read the Word of God for themselves. Also, there are several other things we might want to do. We've talked about and focused on knocking on doors and your conversation, your method there. But it shouldn't stop there. When we look at life, methodology is in practically every aspect of it. And if you don't like methods, then you must love those people when you're driving down the road who don't know where that little switch is on the left-hand side. Now, if you're going to make a left-hand turn, you use your turn signal. If you're going to turn right, you use your turn signal. It's a method. It's something that we've been taught, something we've been instructed to do. Why? Because there's a method to the madness. It works. Why do we stop at the red light when the red light is red and not green? You know, why isn't it the other way around? Because someone put in place that method years ago, and everybody's been following it ever since. Everybody knows that if it's red, you stop. If it's green, you go. If it's yellow, you speed up and you beat the light. But the same thing is true when it comes to personal evangelism. There's nothing wrong with methodology. There's nothing wrong with having a game plan. What are you going to do? Now, when it comes to us individually, it branches out a little bit larger. When we talk about knocking on a door, that's a micro aspect of personal evangelism. That's looking at the tree. But there's also a macro aspect, which is looking at the forest, looking at it at the big term. Do we have a method and a plan for going door to door on a wide scale? How can we get ready to evangelize our town for Christ? What do we need to do? What are some things that we might do to get ready for it? What might be some things that would help us along our way? What are some things that might help us to be better organized so we know what's going on? Because it's not like you knock on, you live on a block in a town and there's only five houses. So how do you know which doors you knock on, which doors that you didn't? How do you know, remember which doors were, you knock on, people weren't home? How do you know which doors you knock on and the person just was not receptive to the gospel at all, wanted nothing to do with it, and maybe chased you away with a shotgun? Well, you get a game plan again. One of the easiest things to do is get a map of your town, create a map of your town, name the streets on it so you can mark off maybe each block as you go, have a piece of paper or a journal where talk to somebody and say so-and-so was interested in the gospel, go back and visit them on such and such a time. You know, just make little notes to yourself. Or so-and-so was not open to the gospel. They stuck their dog on me after they chased me, waving their shotgun. You know, come up with a plan on what you're going to do. Maybe you're going to have a little binder with different tracts in it and Christian literature. Maybe you'll keep it in your car. Maybe when you go knocking on doors, you want to look in your best. Maybe you want to go in a suit or all dressed up in your Sunday best. I wouldn't recommend that, but just go as a casual person. Reason being is we've gotten so used to the JWs going door to door. When somebody sees somebody all dressed up or something like that, they kind of get turned off. They're not going to come to the door anyhow. But everybody has their own approach. Question is, what is our approach going to be? Which I forgot it at home, obviously. I forgot my little binder at home with all my notes in it. But I do want to give you guys a printout that we got in Bible school from our personal evangelism class, because it has a breakdown on this is what happened at this house. It was address so-and-so, or maybe so-and-so answered their name was this. That might be another reason you want to have there, because unless you're the opposite of me, I don't remember names that well. I don't faces maybe a little bit better. You tell me off and make me angry, then I'm going to definitely remember you. I've had plenty of customers do that before. Going to remember that person because somebody else can deal with that. I've been yelled at and cursed out one too many times by them. But the thing is, make mental notes. You know, it makes an impression when you go back and you can remember somebody's name. Jerry Falwell was known for remembering everybody's name. He was known as the man who never forgot a name and never forgot a face. We know some people that live down in Lynchburg, Virginia, where Liberty University is. And he was telling us one time how he was in, I think it was a Japanese restaurant. And there was this man, and he was talking to Jerry Falwell. And he was trying to get Jerry Falwell to remember his name and face. You remember me? And Jerry would go, oh, yeah, I remember you. You saw me over here. Yeah, I saw you over there. And this guy hinted at everything possible to get Jerry Falwell to remember his name. But he didn't remember it. No, we're not always going to remember names. Sometimes we have to write things down. And I'm learning the older that I get, I think I have to write down things that I want to get when I go to the store, and things I want to do, or I forget about doing them. But what's our game plan when we go door to door? You know, we talk about it on an individual basis, but do we have a game plan for the overall? Going on a street, how do we know who we talked to? How do we know who we didn't? If they were receptive, did we get their phone number to keep in contact with them? Did we mark it in our book, their address, that in case we forgot their phone number or forgot to write down, we can go back and say, hey, church is on Sunday, are you coming? You know, how are things going? Are you still serving Christ? Have you been reading your Bible? So we can keep initial contact with our follow-up. Does anybody have any thoughts, any questions? Anything I'm forgetting?
I know a friend of mine. She ordered at least 1,000 manual posters that had pictures in them.
Okay.
And she pasted them out.
I know when it comes to tracks, a lot of people over the years have used chick tracks. Make sure they have some of those on hand. There's lots of different types of Christian literature that we can hand them. It's just a matter of getting them set on the path. The other thing too is once they're accepted Jesus Christ as their personal Savior and made that confession, not only do we need to get them to church, but we also need to encourage them to get baptized to make the outward statement that they have been saved. Water baptism in itself is powerful. Does it do anything for us spiritually? Not really. It's an outward sign that we've put off the old man and put on the new man in Jesus Christ. But it is taking that step of accepting, of proof, showing to everybody else that we have accepted Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. Here in America, it may not be such a big deal, but you realize that in other countries where people are persecuted for the gospel of Jesus Christ, that when a person takes water baptism, that they can be disowned by their entire family, that the state can track them down and possibly kill them because they accepted Jesus Christ as their personal Savior and they made that outward confession. Water baptism is important. It may not spiritually enhance them, but it solidifies the fact that they have accepted Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, and that the life that they are living, they are dead to. They are no longer living that way. So we also want to get them set up along those lines. Is there anything else I'm missing when it comes to methodology, door-to-door, maps, maps of the town, streets, journals, papers to keep track of addresses, phone numbers, names? I forgot all my notes at home. I grabbed the wrong binder. I can only remember so much. But yes, I'm just reiterating from, I think it was 2 weeks ago, when it comes to door-to-door, it doesn't hurt to have a marked Bible, tab it with, like if you're using the Romans Road, maybe have number one tab as the first verse, second verse you're going to use number two, and have them highlighted in the Bible ready to go. That way, if you need to, you can show them right there, this is the Word of God, this is the Bible. The other reason showing them the Bible is important is we don't want them just to take us at our word, but we want to show them what the Word of God states. The what life that we live, the reason we do everything, is not just because someone told us to. It's not traditionalism, but this is the Word of God. This is how God instructed us to live. Over the next couple of weeks, we're going to make a transition, and we are going to start looking at different quote-unquote faiths. Are they Christian? What do they believe? Where are they coming from? I do want to talk about the Roman Catholics, because I know we're all familiar with this, but we live in a very prominent Catholic area. Whether they call themselves Russian Orthodox, whether they're Catholic, you know, there are a lot of people that hold similar to those beliefs. And we talked about the Roman Catholics a little bit when we talked about our series on Babylon, past, present, and future. We saw that the Roman Catholic faith, really their groundwork, came from Babylon. We looked at the Vatican and how it was supposedly built, I think, on an old satanic site. And they adopted the gods of, I think they adopted Zeus and turned him into St. Peter. But regardless, we see the connection there. We want to talk about the Jehovah Witnesses a little bit, because they're, in all honesty, the Jehovah Witnesses put us as Christians to shame. They really do. When it comes to evangelism, knocking on doors, they put us to shame. I've had the Jehovah Witnesses within the last year knock on my door they quote unquote knocked. They saw me walking down the street or got me. One of their elders used to be under me at Walmart. But they got me twice. They knew who I was. But twice they were at my house. What? Oh, if they were here a couple weeks ago, then that's three times they were at my house within the last year. Why do you think the Jehovah Witnesses have to go out so much?
They're required, actually.
They are required, but when you get down to it, the difference between Jehovah Witnesses, and I asked a broad question, I'm looking for this little answer. But when you look at Jehovah Witnesses versus true Christians, they have to constantly go door to door because they are manually building up their church. When you look at Christians, we go spreading the gospel, but it's the Holy Ghost that does the work on the individual's part. You know, they have to work even harder than we do to get recruits. But it still doesn't change the fact that they honestly put us to shame when it comes to inviting people to church. They really do. And that ought to stir each one of us to our utter core that they're out there more than we are. We've been in this community how long, and how many doors have we knocked on? How many doors have I knocked on? How many doors have you knocked on? Even a part of that, how many people have you invited to church? How many people have I invited to church? Now, they put us to shame. They really do. But when we look at Roman Catholics, and notes I'm using here I've taken from Bible school, which of course I'm using someone else's notes to impart, but I always do that. I'm putting a blending or a mixture. But so these notes are at least almost a decade old. But when we look at Roman Catholics, they represent a mission field that is largely neglected. And it is estimated by the Roman Catholic Church that there are about 1 billion Catholics worldwide and about 58 million in the USA alone. But are the Roman Catholic Church, are they really Christian? Do they consider themselves Christian? Back in the day, the Roman Catholics would not have called themselves Christian. They really wouldn't have. Nowadays, they might, but we have to remember, too, and this is just a little bit of church history, but there's been a change in the Catholic Church since, I think it's the 50s, 60s at the latest, where the church kind of split, where you have the old Orthodox, but you have, for lack of better terms, new and reformed. I can't remember what they call themselves anymore. But those are the ones that got away from the Latin Mass, and they kind of got more into spiritual warfare. They might consider themselves Christians, but if we get down to the very core, back in the day, they weren't. In fact, there was a big split if we get into church history. Because what we are Protestants. A result of the Reformation. Martin Luther broke away from the church. Martin Luther broke away from the church for one reason, and one reason alone. They weren't teaching the full Bible. They were doing what they wanted. They had their traditions. They were putting taxes on the people for getting out of purgatory. It was excessive. And he was telling them outright that it wasn't scriptural, it wasn't Bible. Regardless of what anybody thinks, Martin Luther never wanted to break away from the Catholic Church. He just wanted them to follow the Bible to the T. And thus we get the Protestant Reformation, and thus us as Protestants. But Catholics never refer to themselves really as Christian. And if we get down to it, is there even a slight chance that the Roman Catholic Church is really not Christian? If you look at the numbers, and they're all numbers, over 1 billion people have been deceived by the Roman Catholic Church. Their movement was not of God. They had an ecumenical, and of course these are one of these words that get me tongue-tied every time, ecumenical movement, which was not of God. Then they had their own Roman Catholic charismatic movement, which is not of God. Side note on this one. Charismatics, when we think of them and it comes to mind, who comes to mind for the charismatics? Don't have to be one, I'm not looking for one individual per se, but as a group, somebody says, oh, they're charismatic. And I'm talking about as denominational wise.
Pentecostal,
but more specifically, Jesus only. And when we look at Jesus only, a lot of times as Pentecostals, from our end, Pentecostal holiness, we kind of criticize a little bit and say they're emotional, they run off of emotions, because we see a lot of the gifts of the Spirit being in operation, tongues, interpretation, but yet there's maybe not a full change like we believe in. They're still wearing the old, women wearing pants, so forth. They're not quite holiness like we would consider them. Maybe they're going places we wouldn't think to go as Christians. But regardless, charismatic, we see them being used in the gift of spirit and just going off on emotionalism. But along with that, Pentecostal, and well, along with Pentecostal comes tongues. Sometimes not. There's a group of apostolics in our area that are very conservative. They really, really are. They're Jesus only, but they're very conservative.